Wants our company.
We are honest, hard-working men. Why would we have anything to do with groundlings? Be off with you.
The man strengthens his grip on the axe and passes his tongue over his yellow teeth while keeping you in his sights. You shrug your shoulders indifferently and take three small steps backwards without taking your eyes off the men.
All right, if I'm not welcome here, then I'll go.
Good. And don't even think about coming back to stab us in the back or steal from us. We'll keep guard. There's nothing here for groundling scum.
Although your heart is beating wildly, you turn around and walk back to the path without saying a word.
Crawl back underground!
You try to ignore the ridicule. It was a clever decision to go. You're not a good fighter, and taking on a bunch of woodcutters is not part of your mission. You reach the banks of the Warder and can see Axeldale on the other side, but there isn't a bridge for far and wide. The fishermen's boats glide over the water, which sparkles in the sun. None of the men seem to notice you while they throw out their nets. You look at the cold, dark water. The current seems so strong that they could carry off even the most experienced of swimmers. And you aren't even a mediocre one. You once read a legend in a book. Elria, the goddess of water, did not like the children of the forge and cursed the dwarves, so that they would drown in any waters beyond their kingdoms. The main reason that dwarves avoid water to this day. You call to the nearest fisherman. He looks across at you briefly before turning away and getting back to his work. You're going to have to find another way of crossing the river. You leave the peaceful banks of the river behind you and continue on your way. You look down on a large village on the banks of the Warder. Some of the village is built on stilts in the river. A wooden bridge spans the fast-flowing water. A huge wooden palisade has been erected to protect the village from attack. Your eyes roam the land on the other side of the river. You estimate that you will soon have completed half of the journey to Black Saddle. But you still can't make out the mountain on the horizon. The guards on the palisade are watching you. Their armor looks well cared for and well made. The smith who made them knew what he was doing. You conclude that the men depend on the protection the armor offers and aren't just wearing them to look good. They're certainly not villagers. You have spent the last nights under bushes on the hard, cold ground. You are yearning for a good meal and a real bed. You have spent the last nights on... The stakes look a bit different here. You want to look a little closer, but the guard on the other side is vigilant.
Get lost!
The stakes look a bit different here. You want to look a little... There are small fires burning every 50 steps or so. They are intended to light up the area in front of the palisade in the night, so that orcs can't creep up to within an arrow's reach without being seen. There are small fires burning. The wooden palisade encompasses the whole of the large village and is guarded by many men in armor. The stronghold has been constructed in haste, probably only over the last few days, but the work is sound, and uninvited guests should find it difficult to gain access.
Orc skulls?
You're not sure it's wise to taunt the beasts with the severed heads of their fellow kind.
Orc skulls?
The double gate is made of strong planks, sturdy but still much less solid than the fixed parts of the palisade. Security has been foregone here for practical reasons. Never a good idea when building fortifications. Some of the guards begin to whisper as you near the gate.
Hello up there! What brings you to fair good water? And have you seen any orcs on your travels, groundling?
The man leaning over the palisade eyes you up and down carefully.
I'm a dwarf, I'll have you know, just like you are humans and not overgroundlings. So will you let me in now?
I regret to inform you that we cannot allow you to enter. The gates stay closed once night has fallen.
There is certainly no regret showing in the man's face. The orc heads on the spears look fresh, a fact that causes you unease for more than one reason.
Those won't scare orcs away.
I hope not. The more orc heads that end up on those spears, the more gold coins end up in our pockets. Right, boys? Yeah, that's right! Yeah! We've killed our fair share of orcs and know how to motivate them. Those ugly mugs will spur them on, and then they'll perish in front of our gates.
Two things become clear to you. Firstly, that the mercenaries the villagers have hired are excellent at killing orcs, and secondly, that they sadly have no brains at all.
When did you kill these orcs?
Yesterday. We caught a couple of their scouts first. The others tried to take revenge in the evening. Let's see who'll turn up today.
Do you want me to be mauled by the orcs? Let me in.
You're pleased to notice that your voice sounds more accusatory than worried. The free peoples of Girdleguard have always stood side by side against the beasts of Teon. The mercenary seems to weigh up his options, but then shakes his head.
Put a few miles between yourself and us, and then you should be safe. As safe as you can be, these days.
I'm a blacksmith. And a dwarf. Let me tell you, your gate might look solid, but it won't withstand a real orc assault.
The murmuring all around him makes the man pause for a moment. If anyone else had criticized the stronghold, they'd have been laughed down and shooed away. But no one understands defense systems like the dwarves.
A dwarf blacksmith who just happens to be standing in front of our gate?
I'm a skilled craftsman, and I'm sure I can improve this gate for you. I'm a dwarf, and I know of the dwarven art of building from books.
A bookworm? You're going to strengthen our gate with papier-mâché?
I'm sure papier-mâché would help, but that's not what I...
You stop mid-sentence. The mocking expression on the mercenary's face tells you that a white lie would have worked better. You'll have to try something else.
I've got 20 pieces of gold here, looking for a taker in the village.
Ah! One of your folk might leave his post for 20 pieces of gold, but I say, clear off, groundling! The gates stay closed until tomorrow morning!
But... Orc skulls?
You're not sure it's why. The double gate is made of strong planks. Sturdy, but still much less solid than the... The wooden palisade encompasses the whole of the large village and is guarded by many men in armor. You think about waiting by the fire until the morning. At least you wouldn't have to go cold. Is this to be your bed for the night? A flat, cold hollow under a bush? At least you wouldn't be discovered immediately. As you get closer to part of the palisade, you hear whispering from the other side.
Psst! Groundling!
You look around and reach the palisade with a few quick steps. No one saw you. You see one of the mercenaries through the gaps in the palisade. He looks around nervously.
40 gold pieces, did you say? Who are you? Why are you helping me? Not everyone is paid as well by the villagers as our honourable commander. And you're a dwarf. Dwarves and orcs are deadly enemies.
The young man looks around nervously.
So, how about it? 40 gold pieces and I'll let you in.
I offered your commander 20 gold pieces to open the gate.
I can't open the gate for you, but I can let you in. There's a secret sally port just here. 30 gold pieces.
I won't give you any gold at all, but I will let you keep your head on your shoulders.
The young soldier blinks at you in surprise. He's left speechless for a moment.
How are you going to chop my head off from there?
I won't. Your commander will take care of that once I've told him you were going to betray him. Unless, of course, you let me into the village.
The young man isn't much of a thinker. Perhaps a peasant that was lured by the smell of adventure. He looks at you helplessly, and as your expression is resolute, he finally gives in.
All right, but don't say anything.
You decide not to sneak around the village for too long and hide in some straw in a barn. You sleep uneasily, afraid you'll wake up at any moment with a knife at your throat. You don't feel very rested the next morning, but you manage to cross the bridge without incident and leave Goodwater behind you. You have spent... There are small fires. The wooden palisade. The stakes.
Orc skulls. Orcs.
The double gate. Some of the guards.
Goodwater is well known for its hospitality.
A fact that you've just made up yourself.
Let me in, and I will tell other travellers all about it.
I regret to inform you that we cannot allow you to enter. The gates stay closed once night has fallen.
There's certainly no regret showing in the man's face. The orc head.
I hope. Yeah! We've killed
two things
yesterday. Do you
the mercenary?
I'm a black.
The murmuring.
That's right. I can see to it that orcs crack open their skulls on your gate, just like at home on the High Pass. Skulls that add up to hard cash for you.
You only know about the Secondling Stronghold from books, but you can see in the man's face you've pushed the right buttons.
All right then. You can spend the night in the village. You begin work tomorrow morning, and in a better world like you promised.
Of course. It's a trifle.
After a meal, you spend the night in the comfort and shelter of a Goodwater tavern. The next morning, you feel fully refreshed. You strengthen the gate with cross braces of wood and iron, using your experience and skill. Now it should be able to withstand an attack for much longer. Mercenaries and villagers alike watch you work, clearly impressed. As you finish, a man approaches you.
Well done, dwarf. We were right to bring you into our village.
The village grew rich through bridge tolls, and this wealth must be defended. You're proud of what you've achieved in such a short time. You've even invested more time than was wise.
I was happy to help. But half the day is lost, and I must be on my way.
A strong dwarf like you will always be welcome here in Goodwater. Be careful out there. Who knows where the orcs might be lurking?
An uneasy feeling has been your constant companion since you left Goodwater. Every little sound in the forest makes you fear you've been discovered by a horde of orcs. But you reach the end of the day without bumping into any of the greenskins. It seems as though Vrakus has granted you one more day in Girdleguard. As night begins to fall, you pass a large oak tree and decide to call it a day. Near the oak tree is an abandoned camp with a fireplace, which appears to be a couple of days old. You take over the abandoned camp as your own. Whoever slept here before clearly left again without any problems. You see that as a good omen and lie down to sleep. You dream of orcs who creep up on you in the night and even imagine you can smell the rancid fat of their armor. The stench gets stronger and makes you gag. You force your eyes open and look straight into the face of an orc who is holding a knife to your throat. Before you fully realize the hopelessness of your situation, you feel the blade cutting through your jugular. The last thing you see is a group of orcs baring their teeth coming towards you. Then everything turns black. An uneasy feeling has been your constant companion since you left Goodwater. Every little sound in the forest makes you fear you've been discovered by a horde of orcs. But you reach the end of the day without bumping into any of the greenskins. It seems as though Vrakus has granted you one more day in Girdleguard. As night begins to fall, you pass a large oak tree and decide to call it a day. Near the oak tree is an abandoned camp with a fireplace, which appears to be a couple of days old. You take over the abandoned camp. Whoever slept here before clearly left again without any problem. You see that as a good omen, but don't want to rely on your luck and force yourself to stay awake. Some hours later, you jolt from an uneasy sleep. And terrified, you look around you. Relieved, you notice that the forest all around is just as calm as it was before. You promise yourself that this won't happen again. And look straight into the face of an orc who is holding a knife to your throat. Before you fully realize the hopelessness of your situation, you feel the blade cutting through your jugular. The last thing you see is a group of orcs baring their teeth coming towards you. Then everything turns black. An uneasy feeling as you swing yourself up the trunk and then pull up your baggage after you. You're prepared to sleep in a tree like a bird if it means escaping the orc's attentions. You sling your rope twice around your stomach and the trunk of the tree to stop you from falling accidentally. You close your eyes and dream. You see North Pass and smell the fresh, icy wind that sweeps over the peaks of Great Blade and Dragon's Tongue. But the harmony is interrupted by the hideous roar of an unending flood of orcs throwing itself unceasingly against the fortification. You smell the disgusting green blood of the orcs and taste the rancid fat of their armor on your tongue. The bitter taste becomes stronger until it's unbearable and wrenches you out of your dream. You open your eyes and are surprised at the brightness as a glance at the sky confirms that it's still night. Your eyes move towards the ground, and what you see makes the blood in your veins freeze.
I am Synthras of Son Balsur, my master, Nod On the Doublefold, ruler of the Perished Land, has elected you, the Lords of Taboribor, to be the sword that conquers the South.
You mean, you want us to put our necks on the line and be killed by some magus?
Lord Yonan and the others will be taken care of. Your task is to create a diversion in the South until my master's plan succeeds.
And which of us is the leader?
The one that conquers the most land.
So Kragnar will be the new Grand Lord.
He glares at Ushnots and Bashkug.
The Kragnar Shore Tribe will conquer the most land.
Never! We will overwhelm the cities of the Red Bloods quicker than you can suck the marrow from a bone.
We shall see.
You can't believe what you're hearing. If the beasts of Teon ride into battle together, catastrophic cycles lie ahead for Girdlegard. The night in the oak tree was the worst of your life. You spent every single moment afraid that you'd be found and savaged by the orcs. But as the first rays of sun broke through the treetops, the orcs abandoned their camp and left without discovering you.
Better safe than sorry.
Your eyes scan the deserted camp, and you listen carefully for any noise. But you don't see or hear anything suspicious.
Better safe than sorry.
Your eyes scan the... Your eyes survey the foul aftermath of the orc's presence. You don't feel any urge to stick your nose too deeply into the mixture of ripped clothes, leftover food, and feces.
This is the place! I knew it was here! Come on then, find that stupid necklace! Hey, Fuskar! In front of you! A grounding! Perfect for a spotted breakfast!
You know that you're no warrior, but you want to face the orcs as a child of the Divine Smith. Perhaps you'll manage to kill at least one of them, so as not to appear so undwarven in Vrakas' eyes.
I'll give you something to chew on. Vrakas made us of stone.
Whoa.
Oink, oink, little piggies! By Berowyn's beard, how did you manage to lose your weapon? Go and get it, and this time, hold it tight! Hey, that one was mine!
You're just too slow, dear brother!
Too slow? Just wait!
And what now?
Yes?
Huh?
What is it? What is it? Oh, yes. What bad luck for you! Yes?
Huh? Yes.
End it. I didn't hit you very hard. Yes.
What is it?
Come here, you.
On my way.
And what now? Huzzah!
Understood.
What is it?
Come here, you! Who's next? Yes?
End it!
And what now?
Say goodbye forever,
wild creature.
All right. On my way.
Yes. Attack.
What is it?
Yes. Oh, what bad luck for you. All right.
For Vrakus.
Come here, you.
What is it?
Attack.
Yes,
as good as done.
On my way.
And what now?
What is it? With pleasure.
What is it?
Yes, for Vrakus.
Yes?
What is it?
Yes, yes! Come here, you!
Another one bites the dust! Huh? As good as done!
And what now?
Yes.
Huh? I'm with you!
I'm going!
That's all? No more orcs?
Well fought, young friend. Do you happen to be tongued ill?
Well fought? But he fought like a...
Boindeel, what do you expect? He grew up amongst the humans.
Who are you, and how do you know my name?
My name is Boindeel Hookhand, of the clan of the Swinging Axes. This is my brother, Boindeel Doubleblade. We've been sent to find you.
Call me Ironheart. Are there any more piggy snouts around here?
You turned up at just the right moment. But are you sure it's me you're looking for?
The High King Gundrabor sent us to fetch you and bring you to Ogre's Death in the Secondling Realm in the south.
So he received the letter from my master? And am I a Secondling?
Well, something like that, I guess.
There was a meeting last night. The Elfar serve a certain Nod On who calls himself Lord of the Perish Land. They have enlisted 3 Orc Hordes to cause unrest in the south.
Did you hear that, Boindeel? Piggy snouts!
The Elfar from San Balzur and the Orcs from Taboribor are working together?
And could ally with the Orcs from the Perish Land.
The twins look at you solemnly. You all know what that would mean for the people of Girdlegard.
We've got to...
Yeah, I know what you're gonna say, but it's our duty to get you to the Ogre's Death Fortress in one piece.
I thought the duty of dwarves was to protect the innocent in Girdlegard.
Lot Yonan and King Brauron will take care of the orcs. We three must be careful. You're not exactly a warrior.
But he has broad shoulders and broad hands. There's hope for him yet. So when you've got the chance to spit a few orc skulls, you should take it.
Then my family was found and the High King wants to bring me back to my clan.
No, you're not a secondling. You're a fourthling. And you're to...
The High King will tell you all about that once we get to Ogre's Death. We should get going.
I would be happy to follow you into the realm of the secondlings. In truth, there is nothing I would rather do. But first, I must travel to Blacksaddle and return some things to a former famulus of Lot Yonan.
Blacksaddle isn't exactly on our way.
It's on my way. We can head south as soon as I've carried out Lot Yonan's orders.
Well, he certainly got the stubbornness of a dwarf. Perhaps we'll be able to make a real dwarf of him on the way.
All right, we'll accompany you. The sooner we find that famulus, the quicker we can get back to the mountains.
I'll have to send Lot Yonan a message by carrier pigeon on the way. And if we happen to stumble upon a couple of orcs...
I like you, but we'll have to find you another name. Balafar. It's about as good as Lipsmith, Paddletosh, or Blufflegrump. It is stupid, senseless, and definitely not a name of honor. What are you good at?
I'm good at reading.
Reading? You're a scholar?
The road leads up a small hill. From the top, you can see a few farmhouses in the distance. There is smoke rising up from the village, and the battle cries of attacking orcs can be heard even this far off.
Yes? Huh?
Yes, on my way!
As good as done!
What is it? Huzzah!
What is it?
Alright! And what now? Come here, you! Yes?
Yes? On my way.
What is it?
Huh?
Huh?
Blasted trumpeters are calling for reinforcements!
Not for long.
Grrrah! Huzzah! Grrrah! Yes?
Yes?
What now? Ha ha! Yes?
Yes?
Kill!
Attack!
What is it?
What is it?
Huh?
And again!
Not that quick!
Yes!
Yes?
What is it?
What is it?
Huh?
And what now? Come here, you!
Huh?
Huh? At once.
Yes?
Yes?
What is it? Yes, yes!
What is it?
Huh?
End it!
Huh?
Huh?
Oh, what bad luck for you! Ha ha! What is it?
Ha ha!
Yes?
Yes?
Yeah! What now?
Hard.
What is it?
Huh?
What is it?
We're here! Quickly!
Huh?
And what now? Ha ha! Huzzah! What is it?
And again! Huh? Understood.
What is it? Yes? Pow!
Huh? Another one bites the dust.
On my way.
And what now?
Huh?
Attack!
Yeah! Too easy!
End it!
What is it?
Yeah! Another one!
I need help over here!
Come here!
What is it? Yes?
Yeah! Yes, yes! Shoot!
Kill!
Yes?
Huh?
Yeah! And what now? Come here, huh? You!
Say goodbye forever!
Huh? Understood.
Huh? Ha ha!
Yes? Ho ho! What bad luck
for
you!
Put up a fight!
Too easy! I didn't hit you very hard! Too easy!
Yes?
And what now?
Alright!
Always go!
On my way! As good as done!
Huh?
What is it? Yes, yes! Ha ha!
No sooner is the battle won than terrified survivors start to venture out of their hiding places. Women with sheets ripped into strips and buckets of hot water take care of the injured. A man with a blood-encrusted arm approaches you.
My name is Malchius. I am... well, I think that I am now the mayor of this village. Without your help, we wouldn't have been able to stop the orcs. I thank you. And regret that we have nothing to offer you as a reward.
The man's contemplative expression brightens.
Unless, if you want to cross the river, we can ferry you. Everyone for miles around will know your names, for we owe our lives to you. Whenever you want to get to the other bank, just let us know.
You thank him politely and spend the night as honored guests in Malchius's house. All evening, people come to the house to give you small gifts and swear eternal thanks. The next day, you depart. First amidst protest, then grateful cheers. You see a light through the trees some way from the path. It inevitably brings to mind your encounter with the woodcutters. You tell the dwarves about your encounter with the woodcutters and how you ran away, as starting a fight with them wasn't part of your mission.
Ah, then I'll make it my mission! Humans are not our enemies, Boindil.
Thinking about it, they do deserve it.
Boindil grins widely, and before Boindil can stop him, he stomps off. You lie awake in your camp and think about the woodcutter's roast that you had for dinner. The rabbit was the best thing you've eaten in a long time. It tasted of victory. You see a light, you tell
human
thing.
You lie. You and the twins approach Goodwater. A huge army of orcs has surrounded the village on three sides. You see smoke and fire and hear the battle cries. The village is holding out, but for how long?
Ho-ho! Now it's getting exciting! Arches in front of them, three dwarves behind. I wouldn't like to be in their shoes.
And what now?
Yes? For Vrakus!
Huh? With pleasure!
Huh?
Huh?
Ha-ha!
What is it?
Huh?
Who's next?
Huh?
What is it? Come here, you!
Huh?
this?
Kill!
What is it?
Yes? End it!
Oh, what bad luck for you! Yeah! Who's next? I didn't hit you very hard! What is it? Huzzah! What is it? Say goodbye forever!
Yes.
And what now? What is it? Yes? Yeah!
For Vrakus!
What is it?
And what now?
I'm with you!
Yes, yes! Huzzah!
Vile creature!
Yes?
At once.
What is it?
With pleasure.
What is it?
Come here, you!
Yes?
Attack!
Who's next?
On my way.
Huzzah!
Another one fights the devil. Fight.
Yes. At once.
Yeah! What is it? Yes. All right.
And what now?
Huzzah!
Ha ha! For Vrakus!
Come here, you! Who's next?
On my way.
Attack! What is it?
Come here, you! Ha ha! Huzzah!
Of course!
What is it?
As good as done!
For Vrakus!
And what now?
He hardly put up a fight!
I'm with you!
Ow! Another one bites the dust!
Did you see that, men? Now they are warriors! Hey, you down there! I'll send you some reinforcements! Let's stick it to those runts!
All right then, stay close to us.
Yes? What is it?
What is it?
Yes?
Kill!
that yet. Understood.
Huh?
They're hitting me pretty hard!
Of course!
Huh?
Another one bites the dust!
On my way.
And what now?
Yes! Say goodbye forever!
Yes? Understood. At
what? What is it? I'm with you,
huh? With pleasure.
Huh? On my way.
Huh?
Yes? Say goodbye forever. Too easy.
End it.
Yeah!
Understood. For Vrakus!
What is it?
Pow! Another one bites the dust!
I am Boendar! Give me a hand! Now!
Of course!
Yeah! I'm with you!
Ha-ha! Too easy!
Huh?
Yes,
oh,
yes!
Understood.
Too easy!
As good as done! Huh? At once!
And what now?
I'm with you!
Yes! Oh, what bad luck for you!
Yes?
What is it? Yes, yes!
Huh?
End it! Vile creature!
Huh? Come here, you!
Ready?
Quickly!
Huh?
What is it?
Huh?
Huh? And what now?
What is it? On my way! As good as done!
Huh?
Attack!
On my way.
What is it?
Huh? At once.
Huh?
Huh? With pleasure.
Yeah! I didn't hit you very hard.
Understood.
And what now? Of course. Yes? Oh, what bad luck for you. Huh? Ow!
I just another one need bites the dust.
A little rest.
Huh? All right.
The orc's fighting spirit lessens with every fallen comrade. After Kragnar's death, they finally attempt to flee the battlefield. Very few escape the mercenaries' arrows. The leader of the mercenaries approaches you, surrounded by his soldiers. His expression is one of recognition, caution, perhaps even awe.
You're the groundling, dwarf, who reinforced our gate a couple of days ago. It served us very well, just as your axes have.
A young mercenary runs towards you. He has something in his hands that he clearly wants to get rid of quickly.
Commander, we found this on their leader. It feels strange.
The commander looks at the amulet in the man's hand and makes no suggestion that he plans to touch it himself. You take your opportunity.
May I?
You take the amulet and can feel a tingling on your skin. It is clearly magical.
Keep it as a sign of our gratitude.
The commander bids you farewell with a short nod and moves away. It would seem he thinks he's made a good deal. By the evening campfire, Boindil rummages around in his rucksack and pulls out a cheese wrapped in a cloth. He sticks a fist-sized piece on a spit and grills it on the fire.
Ah, there's nothing better than grilled cheese at the end of a long day.
The smell it gives off makes you hold your breath.
Oh, it smells like my socks after weeks of marching in my boots.
Oh, picky, are you? Hardly surprising, considering you were brought up by humans. It's ruined your taste.
Boindil holds the stinky cheese at the end of the stick under your nose.
Eat, and stop complaining.
You pull the warm piece of cheese from the stick. It tastes dreadful. Your fingers will smell of it for the next few days, and probably your mouth will too. The farmstead has been plundered, ravaged, and part set on fire. But not all of the buildings are destroyed. You call out for any survivors, but there is no answer. You remember how you advised the farmer to build a hideaway. From the way things look now, you sincerely hope that he took your advice to heart. You split up and search for signs of life in the burned-out ruins of the farmstead. You take on the main building. You don't find anything, apart from a charred doll. And the twins have no luck either.
Hello? Is anyone still alive? Give us a sign!
The eerie silence that cloaks the ruins remains unbroken. The twins try to persuade you that you've tried everything, and with a heavy heart, you turn to go.
Quick! It's coming from over there!
You free a trap door on the floor of the barn from the rubble of a fallen wall. You open the trap door, and four dust-covered faces blink at you.
Thank Palandio, and thank you, Mr. Dwarf, without you.
Remsa shakes her head rather than finishing the sentence. The joy of being rescued transforms into despondency when Apatia and Remsa see the destruction all around them. They have lost everything.
We should try to reach my sister's farm.
Before you go, take some of our provisions for the journey and take this gold to get yourselves back on your feet.
While Apatia considers how, as a proud farmer, to politely decline the offer, Remsa reaches for the bag with the food and coins in it and nods her appreciation. She knows that this isn't the time for misplaced politeness. The family says goodbye with much thanks. You believe that your gift will at least give them the chance of a new beginning. As you near Calmstead, you see that the surrounding fields are in flames. The sound of fighting reaches your ears. You hear the screams of the villagers and the roar of the orcs.
People in the houses!
Let's get them out of there, and quickly!
And what now? Yes, yes!
Uh-huh.
Attack! What is it? Oh, what bad luck for
what
you!
What is it?
And what now?
Huh? End it!
Huh? Say goodbye forever! Of course! Huzzah! Yes?
Uh-huh.
Yeah! What is it? Ha-ha! Huzzah! And what now? What is it? With pleasure.
Attack!
Huh?
Yes?
And what now?
Yes?
Say goodbye forever!
Huh?
I'm with you!
Yeah!
Pow! Another one bites the dust! Ha-ha! Ha-ha! What is it?
Huh?
What now? Come here, you!
And again!
As soon as the last orc is killed, you and the twins free the remaining villagers.
It would seem the stories are true. Dwarves really are the best orc killers. We don't have much that we can offer you. Maybe we can rustle up some food.
Thank you. We gladly accept the food. It'll help us on our journey.
You say goodbye and continue on your way. Several wagons full of building materials pass you by on the way to Goodwater. The village's fortifications still show evidence of the orcs' attack, but they are making good progress with the repair work.
There they are, the dwarves! Goodwater's saviours, come in! There's always a warm meal and a welcoming bed for you here.
I could get used to this!
You approach Scalebrook through its expansive fields and spot smoke rising up into the sky. A short while later, you can hear the cries of battle, and finally you can smell the tallow on the orc's armor. Scalebrook is at war.
We have to help those people!
Yes, yes!
Huh?
Oh, what bad luck for you! Yeah!
As good as done!
And what now?
What is it?
Huh?
Too easy!
End
what
it.
Is it? I'm with you!
Huzzah!
Say goodbye forever! Oh, what bad yes. luck for you!
Attack!
Yeah!
End it!
Huh?
Yes? My way!
Done?
What is it? Come here, you!
Yeah!
What is it?
Huh? Understood.
Huh? Of course!
Yes?
As good as done!
Yes?
What is it? Come here, you!
Yes, yes!
Yeah!
Ha ha!
Huh?
On my way! As good as done!
Find somewhere safe to hide. We'll come back for you once we've saved the other villagers. On my way!
And what now? Yes?
On my way! Say goodbye forever!
At once. Understood. For Vrakus!
Huh?
Huzzar!
Huh? All right!
Yes?
Yeah!
What is it?
Yes?
On my way!
Uh-huh.
Yeah! Attack!
He hardly put up a fight!
For Vrakus!
And what now? I'm with you!
Pow! Another one bites the dust!
Ha ha!
Huh?
Yes?
At once. End it!
What is it?
Yes?
As good as done!
That
That's it! They're fleeing!
I don't think so. They're just rallying!
And that's what we should do too. Come on.
Thank you so much. You saved us.
Not yet. The orcs are rallying. You must join us.
But we can't.
You must. Here they come.
And what now? Of course.
Huh? On my way.
What is it?
All right.
Huh? Understood.
What is it? Come here, you! Huh?
Yes? On my way. For Vrakus!
Huh?
What is it?
Huh?
And what now?
Huh? Say goodbye forever!
What is it?
Too easy!
What is it?
Huh?
And what now?
Yes? On my way! With pleasure!
Huh?
Please wait a moment!
Attack! What is it?
Ha ha!
Huzzah! Rah! Who's next? Ha ha!
On my way!
Huh? Yeah! At once! For Vrakus!
Huh?
What is it?
As good as done.
Attack!
Yeah!
For Vrakus!
What is it?
Yes? Ho ho! What? Say goodbye forever! Alright!
Yes?
Huh?
Huh?
Let me get it! He put up a fight!
Huh? Understood.
And what now?
Yes? With pleasure. Say goodbye forever.
While Boindil still hunts the last of the orcs through the alleyways of the village, you and Boindil are already helping search for survivors. Various villagers, all with shocked, ashen faces, come and thank you for saving them. A middle-aged man nervously steps from one foot to the other and tries to force a smile.
My father, the village elder, he is dead. I think I must follow in his footsteps, so I thank you in the name of Scalebrook. He left behind some gold. as a dowry for my sister. She's also... she's...
The man bows his head, produces a leather pouch, and kneads it with trembling hands.
If only you'd come earlier.
But before you can reply, the man takes a deep breath and forces himself to look at you.
What am I saying? How ungrateful. Thanks to you, many of us are still alive. My daughter may be able to marry one day, thanks to your bravery.
The man hesitates briefly, then thrusts the leather pouch towards you. You accept the reward with a small bow.
Thank you.
We will bury our dead and rebuild the village. Life goes on, thanks to you, noble gentleman.
You see a camp with a wagon and two people on the edge of the path. Behind them, Black Saddle towers up above a thick, dark forest, about a half a day's journey away. Two horses are standing near the covered wagon, grazing. You can make out the shapes of boxes and barrels on the wagon. The two humans are wearing smart clothes and are sitting next to a large campfire. They don't seem to have noticed you yet. You don't want to give them a shock, so you address them while you're still a distance away.
Hello, friends. Is there any space by your fire?
The two traders look up and visibly jump when they see you three dwarves.
Ah, hello! Aha, yes, of course!
It doesn't escape your attention that you seem to be causing the traders some uneasiness, but you take up their offer and sit down. The twins follow your example.
We're only travellers. We're looking for someone who's said to live on Black Saddle. A hermit.
Someone who lives here?
The traders exchange amazed looks.
If they live here, they must be mad.
Normally we wouldn't stop and rest here, but the horses are too exhausted. Our departure from Perista was delayed and we must have driven them too hard.
Why does Black Saddle make you feel uneasy? It doesn't look particularly inviting, but it's only a mountain.
Only a mountain? You don't know the legend.
The trader looks at you and the twins for affirmation, but you all shake your heads.
Black Saddle was once known as Cloud Piercer, and it towered up into the heavens, the upper slopes of pure gold and the summit covered in snow. The humans wanted to attain this wealth, but the smooth slopes and the dazzling summit made the climb impossible. They called on the dwarves to help them. They were able to tunnel up through Cloud Piercer to the top. They hollowed it out and carried away the gold. The humans demanded that the treasure be shared, but the dwarves refused, and as they argued, the mountain began to tremble. There were too many holes inside for it to hold together. It collapsed and buried both greedy parties underneath it. The mountain lost its tremendous size and its beauty, and ever since has haunted both humans and dwarves with its erosive hatred, causing even the rocks to turn black over time.
Pfft, never heard of it. Sounds like human tittle-tattle. Dwarves would never hollow out a mountain so much that it collapses.
You come from Parista. How are things there?
No news to speak of, I'd say. Well, except for Nudin the Knowledge Lusty.
You know Nudin the Knowledge Lusty. Lot Yonan introduced him to you many years ago during a visit.
What about him?
Oh, nothing really. Just rumors.
You nod at the trader to continue.
He's behaving strangely and disappears into his tower for days on end.
And he looks ill, apparently. Well, that's what someone I know said. Perhaps he got a spell wrong.
Later in the night, after eating together and some friendly conversation by the campfire, you all decide to sleep, but you take the first watch. It's a night in which nothing happens, and the next morning the traders set off early. After breakfast, you also continue on your journey. After a march through the thick pine forest, Black Saddle, the sinister tabletop mountain, and your journey's destination rises up before you.
Are you sure that the Famulus lives here?
Yes, according to Lot Yonan.
Although you try to put a lot of assurance into your voice, you too see no signs that anyone lives here.
No castle, no tunnel, no camp. There's nothing here but mountain.
Then we'll have to take a closer look.
You do that, scholar. We'll be waiting for you here.
You think about objecting, but it would just be a waste of breath.
Found anything? A hidden camp? A secret doorway? Gold?
No. Not yet.
Found anything?
No.
Found anything?
No. Even the dark, evergreen forest seems to be afraid of the Black Mountain. No trace of Guren here either. If he's close, then there must be some kind of cave somewhere in the mountain. I can only climb a little way here. There must be a better way. An old tree. Looks like it could fall down at any moment. There we go. Gwyn is here, then he is further up. I should find some kind of clue before I climb down again. If Gwyn is here, then he is further up. I should... Too steep. I can't get a grip anywhere. I should be able to get up here. That was close. I hope this is all worth it. I should have a look around here first before I climb down again. I should have a look around. Here's a...
No, forget it. Definitely a rock face. There's something engraved on it.
You realize with surprise that they are runes in the Dwarven language.
Built with the blood of our enemies, be unyielding as the rock, and soak the land in their blood. Huh? Hello? Master Gwyn! Lord Yonan sent me to bring some items back to you. My inquiries are almost at an end. That means I can finally go to be with my sunshine. I have never been to Greenglade, but I think I will like it there. I deposited my most valuable things in the grave of Horangarth before my departure and secured it with magic. The password is...
You recognize the following words as rune names, but they're written in the learned language, so you don't know which they are.
Greenglade. Oh, great. Useful. An eternal flame. I know who taught him that.
You see sketches and notes on the architectural features, statues and wall reliefs. It seems Gwyn spent a lot of time studying this place.
Maybe he's kind of a dwarf historian, or maybe he's just a treasure hunter. Gwyn is in Greenglade to visit his sunshine. Greenglade is in Gauragar. We can't have fallen in love with a pointy ear, can he? Hello? Is anyone there?
It looks as though Garen lived in the fortress for a while. It also seems that he left several lunar orbits ago.
It's not stealing. It would just be a shame if the provisions went off. Born of stone, forged in battle. Arise, reborn from the blood of the enemy.
You're not sure if you really want to know what was once in this basin. The whole place gives you the feeling that a decent dwarf shouldn't hang around too long.
Graves. Could be buried here. Rune. Clearly magical. Sarcophagus. Perhaps I could open it. I'd rather not hit it again. The sarcophagus is protected by some kind of magic. That's it. Garen's most valuable belongings. Letters from his lover, a silk scarf that must have belonged to her, and a medallion.
A series of weapons that are all clearly of dwarven origin. The spider webs and rust suggest they have been here for quite a while, maybe even centuries. You have difficulty deciphering the scroll.
Throw the firstlings in the forge. Beat the secondlings to a pulp. The fourthlings are... The rest is illegible. The fortress belongs... It belongs to the dwarf haters. Lorimba's dwarves are not only as unyielding as a mountain, they are also as destructive as an avalanche, and would batter into lesser kingdoms just as relentlessly. The four should find no salvation in Vrakas, only eternal damnation, so that they suffer indescribable torment between the worlds.
You have heard of the dwarf haters, but this is the first time you have read their hateful words. You feel sick and turn away.
Lorimber, the progenitor of the Thirdlings.
In most of the chronicles about the five dwarven kingdoms, only very little is written about the Thirdlings, and what is written is full of disgust. They are called traitors, or worse. It would seem that even the Thirdlings worship Vrakas, but in all the other kingdoms, his shrine would be the biggest. Not the statue of the kingdom's progenitor. A couple of gold coins are in the bowl in front of the shrine.
Can't do any harm.
So, scholar, what are the results of your inquiries?
There is an abandoned fortress in the mountain, and I think it belonged to the Thirdlings.
Boindil's eyes narrow.
The blasted dwarf killers!
A Thirdling fortress? Here? In the middle of Girdlegard? We must let High King Gundrabur know about this.
The fortress has been long abandoned, by the looks of it. Anyway, I can't go to Ogre's death until I have completed my quest. Goren is in Greenglade. The High King, why do you want to bring me to him?
All right then. It's about the choice of the new High King. Dandagar, the King of the Fourthlings, is with his entourage in Ogre's death and is supposed to ascend the throne.
But our acting High King Gundrabur wants to prevent that from happening. He fears that Dandagar wishes to instigate a war against the elves.
But what have I got to do with that?
Boindil is about to say something, but is silenced by a nudge in the side from his brother.
High King Gundrabur will explain everything when the time comes.
You look distrustfully from one twin to the other. Boindil has donned an innocent expression, and Boindil doesn't give you the impression that he has anything else to say on the matter.
Thirdling fortress, here, in the heart of Girdlegard. That's strange, isn't it?
And worrying. But they've always been wily. They move in the shadows and kill there too if they can. Do you know their story?
I've read about it. Lorimber, their progenitor, rejected the name that Vrakas gave him, who in turn did not give him any special talents, so his kingdom studied war.
It helps them defending the East, but it also meant they ended up confronting the other kingdoms. No dwarf would ever even think of injuring one of his kind, never mind killing him. But the dwarf killers are proud of it. When they were even more powerful, they wanted to become the rulers of all dwarves. They are envious of our skills. They haven't been heard of for a long time, but you can be sure there isn't a single dwarf alive who doesn't hate them.
What does this King Gandagar have against the elves?
Dwarves and elves just don't get along. Vrakas and Satalia made us that way.
I know that, but going to war for just that, after all this time?
Well, there must be more behind it. They say that the King of the Forthlings is full of hatred and is a hothead in this matter.
Whatever, your High King must wait. I have a quest to carry out in Greenglade.
But our quest is...
Boindil raises a placatory hand and throws his rucksack onto his back in preparation.
Let it be, dear brother. Look at him. He has made his decision, and you will not be able to change his stubborn dwarven mind.
You can't help but smile. There are dead orcs lying in the defensive trenches and strewn over the meadows in front of the city. Some of the locals are busy throwing the bodies on pyres, while others repair the minor damage done to the city wall. You enter the city and the garrison at its centre without being spoken to. It is only when you reach a heavy oak door that leads, you assume, to the commanding officer's headquarters, that you are halted by a guard.
Dwarves, eh? Seems we aren't to be spared anything these days. What do you want?
It looks like you've got an orc problem.
Had. Our scouts detected the army early on and we were able to repel them without any great losses. A small army of orcs like that couldn't breach our mighty walls.
Your mighty walls look like they're about to collapse under their own weight!
The soldier isn't intimidated by Boindil. He juts his chin out confidently.
At least they stopped the orcs, unlike your dwarven walls in the north.
I didn't know that Steepleton was so big. Impressive place.
We have fertile meadows. That's what we have to thank for the city's growth in recent years. At the time of my grandparents, Steepleton was nothing more than the tower on a hill with a couple of houses. Now we have a market, a temple, and of course, there are royal messengers stationed in the tower, which doesn't do the city's coffers any harm at all.
You said you had messengers here. I'd like to send a carrier pigeon to Lot Yonan in Yonandar.
Lot Yonan in Yonandar. No problem. It will cost you 90 gold pieces.
Well, if that's how it is, then I'd rather do without the carrier pigeon.
The guard nods sympathetically.
The service is expensive, but carrier pigeons are the quickest way to send a message.
I must speak with your commander.
Commander Valor doesn't have time. He's still very busy dealing with the aftermath of the orc attack.
Commander Valor is dealing with the Orc problem, and I have important information concerning it. I witnessed a meeting of the Orc Lords.
The guard eyes you with interest and tries to judge whether you can be trusted. Finally, he stands up, opens a door, and enters the room ahead of you. The commander looks up from his work. The guard repeats what you told him.
Your information about the Orcs could be useful. We have fought them back, but not yet defeated them. Come in.
The commander listens attentively, and now and then asks questions, as you tell him about the three Orc armies and the meeting of the chieftains with the Alf Syntharas.
This sounds very grave. I will send out messengers. We must be prepared.
The Orc army that attacked you was able to escape?
What was left of it? They headed south. Unfortunately, I can't send anyone after them until the damage to the wall is repaired.
To the south? Towards Scalebrook, perhaps. We defeated an army of Orcs down there. It wasn't an easy fight, but they'd already taken a bit of a beating. By Steepleton's soldiers, I assume.
The commander looks at you and seems torn for a moment. Then he pulls himself together.
Perhaps you didn't know, but the administration had a bounty on the heads of that horde of Orcs. Here. This gold is well deserved.
Would it be possible to send a carrier pigeon to Lot Yonan in Yonandar?
Lot Yonan the Magus? Certainly. And as you crushed the Orcs, I'll waive the fee. Let me send for a scribe.
Thank you. But I can write the message myself. Paper and ink will be sufficient.
The commander nods. You don't blame him for thinking you're illiterate. Very few ordinary folk can read or write. Once the writing materials arrive, you write down a summary of what happened at the meeting of the Alf and the Orcs on a tiny piece of paper. A messenger takes the note, nods, and leaves the room.
We must press on. Farewell, Commander Valor.
Kill as many Orcs as you can, Dwarves. Palandi will be with you.
While taking a rest, you see a cart trundling along the road not far away from you. A young couple are sitting on the box seat, clearly in love and more interested in each other than the rest of the world around them. The sight reminds you of a long, unanswered question.
So, I was wondering, what do female dwarves look like?
Pretty!
Very pretty!
Uh-huh.
You were expecting a little more information.
Do they have beards?
No, I would say it's more like fluff. Oh, very attractive.
And what do they do? I mean, are they warriors too?
In our kingdom, most take care of domestic life. They take the animals down to the meadows in the valleys, make sure the larders are full and that there's plenty of good beer, and make our clothes.
It only ever causes problems when men and women stand shoulder to shoulder in battle.
Some of them are talented stonemasons and smiths. And beware of insulting their skills. They are no less proud than we are.
You arrive at a crossroads with a tavern on the corner. A warm light is emanating from its window, lighting up the road around it. A stone sculpture of a sheep stands in front of the door, and above it a sign, swaying gently in the breeze, reads, "The Stone Sheep." You observe the surroundings, but the road is empty and no one leaves the tavern. You notice a broken window on the first floor, which has been boarded up with planks. Something wet drips onto your nose, and you look up to the cloudy sky with a bad-tempered expression.
Why are we standing here and just getting wet from the outside?
You enter the tavern with a determined stride, and are greeted by a thick wall of pipe smoke. The dozen or so drinkers at the tables turn towards you, then give each other astonished and slightly worried looks. You walk to the nearest empty table with the twins in tow and sit down. The landlord comes out from behind the bar.
What can I get you?
You hear surly muttering from one of the tables.
What are groundlings doing showing their faces here, now of all times?
You turn to the guest who'd muttered something about groundlings.
And why is it so strange that we're here?
The man glances up briefly and then stares drunkenly at his tankard and mutters with a slur.
Don't play the innocent. The orcs are terrorizing our lands. And whose fault is it? You let them in.
I was not at the stone gateway, and I don't know what happened. But you can be sure of one thing. Dwarves would never cooperate with orcs. We kill them no sooner than we say them, or my name isn't Boindel Doubleblade.
The drunkard and his neighbour are given a start. They mumble an apology and turn their attention to the beer in front of them.
I wouldn't mind a pint of ale.
The landlord nods and takes the twins' order too. Shortly after, he returns with your beers and puts them down in front of you.
Is that all?
The two travellers pass this way. One was a famulus, the other a mercenary.
The landlord shakes his head indifferently and mumbles something incoherently. One of the guests is about to say something, but shuts up when the person next to him gives him a poke. You turn to the guest who is silenced.
Were you going to say something, my friend?
I'm not your friend, and I wasn't going to say anything either.
The man glances at his neighbour and then turns his attention back to his beer. You stand up and turn to the room.
This round's on me.
The faces of the guests and the landlord brighten up immediately. The landlord gets to work pulling everyone a beer and handing out the tankards. Some of the guests say cheers to you as they get their drinks.
Come on now, tell us what happened. We're all friends here.
The man who was going to speak the first time round looks over to his neighbour, who nods.
Two travellers spent the night here. One had a robe on, the other was a mercenary. The next day they left, all in a hurry. Said they'd been attacked by an elf.
One of the other drinkers finds his voice too.
There was a hell of a lot of noise that night. As if there'd been a dust-up.
There's some gold here for the trouble. I thought they meant the noise, but then I noticed the broken window.
The landlord sighs.
Please don't tell anyone else about this. Who would want to spend a night in a tavern where an elf has been sighted?
We're tired and long for a proper bed.
Of course, gentlemen.
You spend a restful night in the tavern and then head off on your way again. colourful trader's wagon drawn by two stocky horses is coming towards you. A small man is sitting on the box seat, and as soon as he sees you, the wagon slows down. As it draws to a stop next to you, you realise that the driver isn't human. He's a dwarf.
Greetings, my friends. All too rarely does one meet wayfaring dwarves around here. You can call me Mort.
Greetings, Mort. I am Tungdil. This is Boindil and Boendal.
You are happy to meet another dwarf, and such a friendly and eloquent one at that.
Wayfaring dwarves may not be common, but a travelling dwarf trader? Now that really is weird.
Then you see what great luck it is that we've met like this. Come, have a look at my wares. I'm sure you'll find something to make a dwarf's life a little sweeter. I'll make you a good price.
Mort, I hope you don't mind me asking, but which kingdom are you from?
The dwarf's clothes seem more like those of humans, and he isn't bearing any coat of arms.
My kingdom? Is that important? I'm my own kingdom. I go where I please and enjoy the fresh air and the sun on me skin.
At your side, Boindel is tensing his muscles, and you think you see from the corner of your eye his hands moving a little nearer to the handle of his axes.
Is your kingdom important?
You two must be secondlings, right? I can tell by your armour. But you...
He looks you over for a while.
You're not a secondling, are you?
As you yourself don't know for sure which kingdom you belong to, you give no answer and just shrug your shoulders. Mort throws you a knowing glance and nods slowly.
Where are you heading?
To Clintel, a small village where I can expect to do very little business. But the people there are nice and kind. I've known some of them since they were smaller than me. Isn't it astounding how much they managed to achieve in such short lives?
After glancing at Boindil's grave expression, Mort continues unfazed.
I can say in all certainty that there's not the same ambition to make a difference and change things in our halls.
That is because there is no reason to change things if you do them right first time. We dwarves think first before acting.
As it is Boindil of all people making such a claim, you're sure it must be a joke. But your friend continues to eye the trader with a serious and distrustful look.
I grew up with Magus Lot Yonan in Yonandar. I would have given anything to meet someone like you.
I rarely leave this area. People know me here, so the abuse isn't too bad.
Mort shrugs his shoulders, as if it were no big deal. When he sees the concerned look on your face, he adds,
I don't blame them. It's our fault too. We turned our backs on other races. People fear what they don't know.
We must press on. It was a pleasure meeting you, Mort.
Mort smiles.
The feeling is mutual, Tungdil. Vrakas be with you.
Mort spurs the horses on, and the colourful wagon jolts into motion.
You shouldn't be so trusting.
The wagon is no more than a few yards away when Boindil looks at you reproachfully.
A dwarf who lives alone among humans for years on end and disowns his kingdom? Don't you know what that means?
He's an outcast, Tungdil. His kingdom and his clan have banished him. It's a severe punishment, only dealt out for serious offences.
The twins enter into a long discussion about what crime the trader may have committed, and go on to teach you the basics of dwarven law. As dramatic as their accounts may be, you didn't have the impression that Mort was a criminal, nor that he suffered particularly from his exile. The hamlet of Sungird certainly lives up to its name. You arrive as the sun sets behind the tower of a Palandial temple, lighting up its stained glass. There's a shop in the village, and through the window, as well as some everyday objects and food, you also spy a shelf full of books. A small bell rings as you enter the shop. The twins look around, but seem rather disinterested, until they discover a couple of gemstones on display. On the wall to your left is the bookshelf you saw through the window. It's quite unusual for a village shop to sell books. You stroll towards the bookshelf and read some of the titles written on the spines of the books. You know many of the works from Lot Yonan's library.
Oh, by Vrakus, look, dear brother! The scholar really is looking at books!
It's an interesting selection, Boindil. I could make some recommendations for you.
Boindil throws his arm around your shoulder and pulls you slowly away from the bookshelf.
What if someone sees you? Here, this is more our kind of thing.
You follow him reluctantly and are shown the selection of gemstones. Boindil is walking next to you in silence. Now and then, he looks at you from the side.
And you really do like books?
Yeah, I'm curious. And you can find many answers in books.
Won't you have found all the answers at some point?
Quite the contrary. The more books you read, the more questions you ask.
Ah, I knew it. Oh, just a waste of time.
The closer you get to Parista, the livelier the streets become. Many of the large buildings in the city are even taller than the high city wall. But one building towers above them all, the palace. Its dome gleams white in the sun. It is the seat of the Council of Magi, and its central tower, which juts high into the sky, serves as a waypoint for travellers as far as 50 miles away. You reach the Council's palace, but are stopped in front of its gates by a guard.
The Council of Magi is convened to take care of the Parish Land. They mustn't be disturbed.
The Parish Land? You mean the barrier? Is there something wrong with it?
The guard shrugs his shoulders.
Won't be anything the council can't sort out.
The inhabitants of Clute Meadow are busy at work in the village and the surrounding fields. They don't seem too worried about the armies of orcs that are prowling around, or they just don't know about them. You near Talborough, the capital city of Iddeslane, which nestles in a valley on the edge of the Misty Vale. In the city you hear that King Tilagorn and his cavalry have returned. You head to the parade grounds, where you see a broad-shouldered man, about 40 years old, inspecting a group of soldiers.
You are King Tilagorn, Lord of Iddeslane, aren't you? I have seen your portrait in books.
The tall man sounds you out, not unfriendly, but vigilant.
You are correct, my friend. This is the first time I have met an educated dwarf.
And it's the first time that I've met a king.
You reply, quick-wittedly, yet truthful. The king cannot help himself but smile.
You are clever and good with words. A sharp tongue is sometimes more valuable than a sharp axe in this world, and more dangerous.
We've fought against orcs in Axeldale and Goodwater.
Axeldale and Goodwater?
The king seems to ponder for a moment, as if he were searching for the names on an imaginary map of his kingdom. Finally, he nods.
How bad is it?
There were losses, but we defeated the orc armies, and both villages are safe again.
You defeated them?
The king sighs with relief, and it seems as though a heavy burden has fallen from his shoulders.
I'm glad to hear that. We were pressed to make it there on time. We rode for 4 days and 4 nights to get thus far. I didn't want to stop, but the horses needed rest, and we had to take the wounded to the capital after the orcs' onslaught.
Tiligorn takes a deep breath and breathes out calmly.
The good news is certainly welcome. Thank you very much, my friends.
You politely take your leave of the king. He promises to take care of the dead bodies in Axeldale and Goodwater. And from his determined expression, it is clear what he would do to any orc that comes too close to his army. You near Talborough, the capital city of Iddeslane, which nestles in a valley on the edge of the Misty Vale. When your journey leads you once more to Carmstead, the villagers recognize you from far off and greet you warmly. Once the children notice you, they come running and bombard you with questions about dwarves. You talk to the children and the villagers until it turns dark, and after a short night, you set off again. As you approach the vaults, you're relieved to see that everything seems to be as you left it. Your heart skips a beat as you see Frala coming out of the entranceway.
Frala!
Tungdil! You're back already!
I'm back, but my journey isn't over. I just need to speak with Lotjonan. I have some disturbing news.
Lotjonan is in Perista. The Magus Nuden ordered him there as there's something wrong with the barrier that restrains the Perished Land. What's happened?
You tell Frala about the meeting between the Elfar and the Orcs, and of the danger for Girdlegard.
That really is worrying. But I'm sure the Famulai could defend the vaults if Orcs strain to these parts.
That's what you think, too. A Magus is as valuable as an army, and the vaults full of Famulai should have no problem with a horde of Orcs.
Tell Lotjonan what I've seen. I need to get going. It would appear that his Famulus is in Greenglade, not Blacksaddle.
Greenglade? Don't elves live there? You really do get around, Tungdil. Wait, let me get you something to take with you.
Frala disappears into the vaults, only to return a few minutes later with some provisions for you. You thank her and say goodbye, as she says she must get back to work.
Thank you.
The colourful train...
Farewell, Mort.
Rakkas be with you.
You arrive at a small, bustling village. One thing is clearly missing from the lively scene, the sound of metal on metal from the village smithy that would normally be heard above everything else at this time of day. A dour, grim-looking man is sitting in front of the forge with his right arm in a sling. His expression brightens as he sees you and he jumps to his feet.
Dear dwarves, could I interest you in helping me in my workshop for a day?
The man's expression is somewhere between desperation and hope. As you don't answer immediately, he continues.
You will, of course, be royally rewarded for your work. I can offer you 100 gold pieces.
What happened to your arm?
A stupid accident. A box of blanks fell down. I was trying to catch it. It will heal, fortunately, but I won't be able to wield my hammer for a while.
You must have quite a backlog of work.
You nod sympathetically. You always felt bad if you were ill or couldn't work in the forge for some reason or other.
Loads, but if what I hear about the metalworking skills of the dwarves is true, it would be easy for you to manage it in a day.
You shake your head.
We don't have time, sorry.
The smith seems downhearted, but as you leave the village, you notice two horsemen standing on a small hill, no more than 30 yards away, watching you. You don't pay the horse.
What was that?
There are dead all. You went to.
Hello, ha. You still. What of that? I'm not come. Come on,
We
kill as many.
While taking a rest, the sun...
Very?
Uh-huh.
No,
and,
in Arkin, it only have some of... Th-
you arrive at... You... You... In point, you... You... The...
Oh.
The...
Oh. The... Did you...
The... You... T- I- cut them.
With her.
A colourful
great greeting.
Wait then.
My.
And.
Where are you to. That. I could.
We must.
You should.
He's an out.
The twin. The ham. The. As. You stroll to.
Oh! As.
Boindil.
Yeah, quite.
Ah!
The close. The guard. When as you look at that, that's good. The inhabitants. You need in the
and
the king.
We
the
you
we
till a you polite. The colorful.
Farewell, more
racket.
You arrive at a small, a door demands it.
What happened?
You must I could help you, but compared to
the smith got
double. My services should
anger and indignation are written across the man's face.
That's much too much! I could have the smith in the neighbouring village do my work for cheaper. I won't pay more than I offered. Take it or leave it.
You agree, and the smith nods sullenly. His preconception with the four you.
These two.
You call you.
So Scott.
The men.
No. You.
They're on my mind. We're one tribe, we share our memories clear and bright. We walk as one, our lines are bound together. We share fate, we share one fate. We share fate. From father to son, he made us dwarves, the guardians of the land. Still we carry on, stand side by side. We will defeat the fiercest enemy. 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 We are the chosen.
Thank you.